pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Kathy, you want to do the roll call?
Councilmember Zerfing?
Here.
Councilmember Masters?
Yes.
Councilmember Cramblett?
Here. Okay, so we're back to city council interviews. And the way we're going to do the list on it is we're going to pull his names or the numbers there?
Names.
So we're going to pull, and you're going to pull them?
Yeah.
All right, sounds good. Random.
Mark Storm?
Hey, Mark.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've got a list of questions to ask. And we're going to start with, basically we've got six questions. We had five to start the meeting with on Wednesday, and then we had a sixth one with the list. We look anywhere on that. So we'll ask, we'll start the top here with Lance and start the questions.
Okay. You did see the questions and the issues ahead of time?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so Mark, in your application for the vacancy, you said that your vision for Cascade Locks in the next decade is that you envision a community that works together, enjoys the beauty and recreation that the town has to offer, a clean town, efficient government that supports residents, businesses, and a vibrant tourism industry, and that in a decade you'd like to see a strong pre-K to 12 school, increased access to services for Cascade Locks senior citizens, and more well-paying jobs for our community members. What is the city's role in achieving that vision?
Well, I took all the questions and then I typed them up on a format so it's easier for me to read. And this is my first attempt at a public office. So if I'm nervous or anything else, I'm trying to just be myself. So I'll read this. The city council has a unique opportunity and crucial role in bringing the community closer together and bringing in more businesses and more jobs in the Cascade Locks. The city of Cascade Locks can foster an environment where citizens work together and the city can harness the pride and energy of our citizens to make progress. The city needs to hold more town hall meetings and ensure that the council meetings are respectful and all citizens' ideas are welcome. The city will increase trust by being transparent, open, and welcoming. Additionally, I would like to work toward more community events where citizens are enjoying the community and building positive bonds with each other. In terms of efficient government, I think the city needs to solicit input from the citizens and from committees who may have creative ideas or expertise on the ways to improve city functions or solve problems. Additionally, I think projects need to be thoroughly researched so that costly mistakes are avoided. Regarding jobs and businesses, the city needs to invite new businesses and invite regional companies to locate additional operations in Cascade Locks. We need to work directly with the port in bringing in new businesses to the available sites in the industrial park. Cascade Locks has one of the largest areas of land available for business development in the gorge because of the restrictions of the Columbia River Gorge Commission. We have recently invested in our sewer, water, streets, fire, EMS, and other infrastructure, and we have well over 100 ready-to-build home sites. We need to be reaching out to businesses and letting them know that we are centrally located in the gorge. We have a ready-to-build infrastructure available and willing workforce, a welcoming city government, and once we have restored them, outstanding fire and EMS services. In terms of local businesses already here, relationships can't be forged by sitting in a desk in the city council chambers. The city council members need to get out in the community and visit local businesses to understand the challenges that they are facing and bring them on board and to let them know that the city supports them. With tourism, we need to rebuild and strengthen relationships with regional chambers of commerce and visitors bureaus. We have some really great annual events to build on, like the Festival of Nations and many sailing events, and attract many guests with natural beauty of the area and our outstanding artists and art galleries. But we can do even more. We can improve our appeal with more community events and efforts to beautify the town. In terms of a clean town, a city will benefit as citizens feel more pride and ownership in their town. The city can facilitate this with a beautification award. Each summer, the city council could recognize residents who have improved their house or grounds. Additionally, we can build an existing volunteer cleanup days by involving more citizens and partnering with nonprofit groups like Solve, our local AmeriCorps programs. I fully support a pre-K through 12 school in Cascade Locks, but I think that can't happen until we increase our tax base. Growth is inevitable. As a community, we need to be prepared for it and welcome it. I believe that encouraging growth in the first step is expanding our tax base and reopening our school. I would like to see more services for our senior citizens. This could be achieved by submitting grant applications for increased services and by partnering with agencies in neighboring towns that already serve senior citizens to increase access to these services for our seniors. Cascade Locks has been fortunate to receive grants in the past, particularly for our fire and EMS programs, but there are quite a few grants that we can apply for private foundations that support a wide variety of other direct services for citizens.
So he was going to ask you this question.
Okay.
Next, what is the role of city council in running the city, and what is the role of staff in running the city?
The city council is responsible for setting policy agendas, creating budgets, and providing connection between the people and the government. The city council members need to seek input from citizens and from city staff so they are informed in their policy and budget decisions. The city staff is responsible for day-to-day operations of the city and for providing updates and information to the city council. If the city council carefully researches and considers its decisions in the open manner, including respecting the input from its staff, who have a great deal of knowledge gained from their day-to-day work, then the staff can carry out its tasks with clear direction and efficiency. Respect, collaboration, teamwork, trust, morale will be enhanced in this atmosphere.
So Lance can ask you question number three.
Okay, Mark. Also in your application, you said that the most critical issues facing our community are the cuts to fire and EMS services that endanger the citizens of Cascade Locks, and that it's critical that these services be restored and efforts to reestablish mutual aid benefits be prioritized. You also said that the community needs to work together to increase economic development and promote the growth of Cascade Locks, particularly increasing job opportunities, investing in our youth through promoting resources for the school, and connecting youth with drug-free activities and meaningful opportunities to get involved. And also that our senior citizens need access to transportation, healthcare, and other services. And finally, you said that ensuring the well-being of our seniors is vital to the health of our community. What steps should the city take to resolve these critical issues?
In addition to services that Cascade Locks already offers, I think that we need to restore fire and full EMS services to the city as soon as possible. The city needs to determine the exact steps that need to be taken to restore the services. There have been lots of rumors and opposing statements about how much and when we need to pay on the loan for the fire station. As soon as possible, we need to ask for a report from the city administrator and finance officer to hear the full range of options for financing the restoration of services and the full range of options for repayment of the loan. The port has several parcels of land for sale or lease that can draw businesses and jobs to Cascade Locks. The city and port have worked together to create infrastructure, for example, water and sewer connections to the industrial park on the east side of town. Because of this infrastructure, business development is ready to go. With the port and the new city council, now is the right time to re-energize this effort to bring in jobs to Cascade Locks. The city needs to partner with the port to recruit and welcome businesses by making joint presentations to potential businesses and emphasizing zoning flexibility and other reasonable accommodations. Another way to boost Cascade Locks revenue and to pay for services is to increase the city transient lodging tax by 1%, from 7% to 8%, so that the total tax paid by visitors would be equal to Stevenson and Hood River's lodging tax rates. This would bring us well in over $10,000 annually to Cascade Locks without increasing any tax burden on the citizens. Some of the revenue would be spent on increasing tourism, and some would be used to increase our general fund. The city has an obligation to invest in our youth. The city should find and encourage grant submissions for increased youth services. The city should support and facilitate increased collaboration amongst church youth groups, youth service organizations, and drug and alcohol prevention groups. To maximize and increase services available to youth, I would support youth participation in city council meetings, and as city councilor, I would seek input from youth advisors. I would seek to increase low or no cost opportunities for youth engagement, including supporting AmeriCorps programs, partnering with regional efforts, and increasing adult and youth volunteerism to connect kids to their community. As mentioned previously, the city should support grant submissions and increase collaboration with regional and senior services.
Oh, I'm item four here. How should the city council handle conflict, internal and external?
Internal. Conflict is a natural part of any political process and should be expected with community involvement. Often, the most creative and collaborative ideas come out of conflict. However, for conflict to lead to good results, there needs to be a foundation of respect, active listening, open-mindedness, and trust. Rules of conduct need to be followed at community meetings, and counselors need to be to remember everybody who is serving is passionate about the future and well-being of Cascade Locks. And the external, the council needs to make citizens and neighboring communities feel that the city is open and interested in working together. This can be achieved by holding town hall meetings for the budget process in the future, and by improving access and opportunities for the citizens. The city council needs to be a model of respect and openness to each other and to treat citizens with genuine respect. One way to improve citizen participation in council meetings, town hall meetings, and city events would be to start a community newsletter. This could be accomplished by partnering with nearby colleges or universities to find interns willing to start a newspaper. We can also look at developing a social media presence so that citizens can get council updates via Facebook or Twitter. The goal is to engage citizens, provide positive opportunities to contribute, and really consider their input. Additionally, the council needs to be good neighbors to other gorge communities by reaching out to work together and support them as a way of promoting goodwill.
And number five. What needs to happen in city government in the next 12 months?
My top priorities in following order: restoring fire and EMS services, restoring citizen confidence in government by improving internal city council relations and by re-engaging citizen participation in town halls, city council meetings, and committees, restore and build on relationships with surrounding cities, chambers, and regional associations, and partnership of all kinds to restore goodwill. Increase jobs in the tax base by improving relationships with existing businesses and recruiting new businesses to Cascade Locks.
Last question. The last question is just basically a follow-up. Is there anything else that you wanted to talk about, you know, specifically based off of the basically six supplemental areas that we
have? I, you know, growing up, I'm a true Oregonian. I was born in Oregon. And one of my favorite politicians is Tom Call. And, you know, he created the Oregon public beaches, the bottle bill. He cleaned up the Willamette River. And also, I think the urban boundary system, too, that, you know, he created. And he was really passionate about Oregon. And I think there's a lot of people in town here, you know, that are passionate, you know, for Cascade Locks. And one of the things that, you know, he had said one time, and it was a phrase that, come visit us again and again, but for heaven's sakes, don't come here to live. And I think, you know, sometimes that backfired, and so all these people from California came in, and I think sometimes we don't realize what we have here in Cascade Locks, and I think, you know, sometimes I feel that, you know, a lot of people have a passion in Cascade Locks, but I think if you look at the gorge and you look at the scenic area and, you know, the communities that, you know, I drive every day and I pass Hood River and on my way to work, I come back, and it doesn't matter what time I come back, the cars are backed up on the freeway. You know, I think there's poor planning, but, you know, there's a lot of, you know, building, a lot of half lots now, and high density, they're just building on top of each other in Hood River. And as soon as Hood River is filled, and, you know, Mosier's filled and the Dalles is filled with the scenic area, you know, they're going to go somewhere else, and it's going to come to the debt, and it's going to come to Cascade Locks. And what we need to do is plan for that future. We can't put a gate on it. And with, you know, with our schools, you know, we need the people, we need the numbers. And I think if we plan right, you know, I think, you know, we can have things that we want. But, you know, to do, you know, what's happened to Hood River, you know, with our roads and everything else, I think we need to really think it out so we don't make some of the mistakes that, you know, some of the other communities have made. And anyway, that's my follow-up question. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Well done. Thanks.
Next one is Bobby Walker.
Hi, Bobby.
Hello.
How you doing, Bob? Good.
You're doing fine, Tom.
Good man. So, we're going to be asking questions.
Yep.
And you look over the question, you look over the sheet, all that prepared for that.
Yep.
Okay, so we'll start with Lance, your question one.
Hey, Bob. In your application, you said that your vision for Cascade Locks in the next decade is Cascade Locks will continue to grow and change. I would like us to see Nestle Waters plant up and running, a charter school for K-12, sailing at the expanding beach, a new entrance to the park, and a BMX course. What is the city's role in achieving that vision?
Well, I think the city's role is to work closely with the port. There are some of these things that are more in the port's realm. As an example, the entrance, the new entrance to the park. The park is severely limited by the railroad underpass of the height of vehicles in the park. So I think it's important for the city to work hand in hand with the port to get the Department of Transportation or the Federal Highway Administration, the railroad, all on board to get a new overpass put in. And that will not only help the port, but it will also afford some more possible development in the downtown core area. I think the charter school is one of my pet peeves. I think that it's my personal opinion that the Rivers County School District made a very short-sighted decision when they closed the high school in Cascade Locks. I've lived here most of my life, went to school here, and if you really want to see the difference of Cascade Locks now to 10 years ago, go downtown on a Friday or Saturday night about 6 o'clock and tell me how many kids you see, and and what they're doing, and the answer is going to be very few. I just don't, my kids are grown, so I don't touch base with the student level children anymore, but I just don't see the kids being engaged in Cascade locks anymore. There's, you know, we've got some of them in Hood River and some maybe in Corbett, some folks have moved, and so I think the school itself, when it closed, we lost our focal point. The gentleman before talked about partnering and getting out with the people and seeing what's going on. And that's what the school used to provide this city, in my opinion, was, you know, I might see you at a basketball game and we might sit near each other and you know, just talk about things and, you know, hey, how's this going? What do you think of this? So on and so forth, or a football game. We don't have that anymore. It's, they're whittling us away. I mean, what they took 9 through 12, and 7 and 8, this is our last year for 6th. And so the charter school committee, we're trying to work hard, but we've come up against some real roadblocks. And I just feel that it's harder than it should be. So, but we're still going to try to get a charter school here. I think it's vital to the community of Cascade Locks, and it'll give us back that focal point that we miss so much. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, just the question was, what's the city's role in achieving that vision?
Well, and Nestle Water, I think, is going to play a big part in this. I've been impressed with Nestle so far. They've been very open about dealing with folks. They've done you know, some community outreach with some focus groups, which I liked, because, you know, you look at some of the folks that are not for Nestle, and they have some valid points from their point of view. I don't agree with them all, but you know, I had some concerns at first about, you know, how much water and what they were going to do with it and the traffic and everything. But I think Nestle's a good deal, and I think the city needs to work very hard, and I think they have in the past with, you know, testing the water and the Oxbow Hatchery water trade and everything. So I think we need to continue that. I think it's kind of quiet right now. I haven't heard a lot from Nestle, but I hope that we continue to go down that road, because it's a sustainable enterprise for Cascade Locks. It's not some huge thing that's going to come in and really tax our existing infrastructure. I think it'll provide some employment for some folks, and it'd be good for the city.
And, Bobby, what is the role of city council in running the city, and what is the role of staff in running the city?
Well, I think that our form of government in Cascade Locks is set up to be ran by the council itself, and then the mayor has specific jobs that he does. You know, as all these committees that we have, like I'm on the planning commission, and there's the budget committee, and tourism, we all make recommendations to the council, and the council has the final word on it. The council also, you know, puts in ordinances and votes on, you know, paying the bill and authorizes those kind of things. The mayor himself, his job is to run the meetings under the council rules, to sign documents in an official capacity. It's sometimes to be the spokesman or the liaison for the council. I think the staff is really the nuts and bolts of the organization. Their job is to actually provide those services and run the business side. The city administrator is the general manager of the operation, and then you have your department heads, your public works director, the electrical director, EMS director. And the staff itself, you know, they, like I said, they do the businessing, the billings, and so on and so forth, the day-by-day things.
Thanks.
Okay. Also in your application, you said the most critical issues facing our community are that we must have the courage to collaborate. Without consensus, we're not going to move forward. We have to prioritize what services are critical and how we fund them. We need to hire a new city administrator and put the emergency services back on track. What steps should the city take to resolve those issues?
Well, I think that you're doing part of that right now. This is the beginning of the process. In our form of government, you can't move forward without a full city council and a mayor. And so once we get that back on track, then we can move forward with another active search for a permanent city manager. And through that, that will also allow us to fill some of the other vacancies. We'll decide as a council in conjunction with the new city administrator what our EMS program is going to look like, whether or not we're going to have a paid chief, whether or not we're going to have a paid full-time paramedic, or what that's going to look like.
Tom, can I just clarify, is it okay to ask just a clarifying on that? I don't know if I heard you right. Did you say that we should get a new city administrator? Is that okay to ask? Or you work with the existing one, the one that we have, the interim?
It's my understanding this is an interim city mm-hmm. administrator.
Okay.
And so we're going to have to work towards a permanent one.
Okay, and then after that, as far as the fire and EMS?
Well, we're going to have to decide whether, you know, what that... We're all agreeing that we have to move forward with the EMS system here in Cascade Locks. Well, what's that going to look like compared to, you know, what we can afford and what the people have clearly said is important to them?
Okay. And do you think that can be done? The thing I was trying to clarify is can be done with the, do you feel it can be done with the interim? Or I thought you said that we should wait until the new one comes in.
Well, that depends on how long we're talking about. I don't know, you know, are you going to have the interim position for another month, or are we looking at 6 months? Of course, we can't wait 6 months to fix the problem, but, you know, I don't think we're really going to finalize anything until we get a permanent city manager in, unless you've made some kind of arrangements for a long-term interim position.
So for how should the city council handle conflict, internal conflict and external conflict?
Internal conflict is what I was talking about before with just getting to consensus. We've had a few years now of you know, kind of finger pointing, and it was so-and-so back 5 years ago, and now it's so-and-so. That doesn't get anything done. I think we've spent a lot of energy pointing fingers when we could have used that energy to come up with solutions. There's not going to be a winners and losers in this. That we're all going to be losers unless we learn that, you know, sometimes you got to give and sometimes you got to take. Sometimes you got to pick your battles. It's not a perfect system. There's going to be issues that people are very strong about, and the EMS is one of them, and we've got to come to some kind of consensus that's going to work in the long term. It's been 10 years that we've been fighting this battle, and you know, like I said, nobody's winning. I feel strongly about it, you feel strongly about it. There's got to be some common ground there, and I think the common ground is that everybody wants to do the right thing for Cascade Locks, whether you're for a paid chief or cutting it to the bone. There's got to be some kind of, you know, middle ground that we've got to look at that's going to work for everybody. I think we did a poor job at selling what we had. I mean, I, for one, I didn't know what was going on with the fire department. I didn't go to the department. Eva's my next door neighbor. I would talk to Eva or Jesse or You know, once in a while, I'd talk to the fire chief. I, you know, had a chance to go talk to him and ask him what was going on. You know, there's a lot going on there that I don't think people were really educated about. External conflict, I think, is a tough one for somebody that doesn't do it a lot. I do it a lot at work. I mean, I work for a government agency, so my phone's ringing every day about, you know, you need to do this and you got to do this. I try to be calm and you know, just let people know that you're interested in what their problem is. We've all made calls to City Hall or the school district or the highway department about, you know, some gripe that we had, and all you can do is tell the people you're interested in helping them. You'll do what you can, but if you can't do anything, you got to tell them that too, and just be aware of what they're talking about. You know, sometimes it's an easy little fix, and it's something that we can do right away. But a lot of times it's not. So, just people are so tired of dialing a number and, you know, getting a voice that's, you know, some robot or something. So, I think just listen, let the people know that you're as concerned as they are, and that you'll follow through and do what you can.
Okay. What needs to happen in city government in the next 12 months?
I think the gentleman before me talked about it. With, you know, we talk constantly about being open to the public and everything, you know, being right out there for folks. I think one of the things that we can do is get the heck out of this room. This room itself is a terrible, in my opinion, place to hold public meetings. You got, what, 20 people here, and the room's packed. I think the fire hall has it. Don't they have a nice, you know, room on the side? I know the, you know, the sound and the camera you might have to do something with, but this is not a person-friendly room. And so I think that's one of the things we should look at is I think this room is seen as a day. When we try to do PowerPoints or something, what other meeting have you ever been at where the audience has to turn around and look behind them? It doesn't make any sense. So I think that's one of the things we can do. If we're going to be transparent and we've talked about what we're going to do for the public, that's one of the things that we can do is make it more user-friendly. I think the city has done a very good job in the last year with the website. I think that's a good resource. I'm really happy that they've put in the work that they have. It's very user-friendly. I think it's maybe a little slow sometimes, but I really like that thing. Talked about Facebook and Twitter. You know, that's nice. We have it for ODOT. I don't use it, but, you know, maybe to some of the younger people, that might engage them a little more. Who knows? It's, I don't think it costs that much to set it up. So. I like that idea. I think it's a good idea. But just if you're going to try to make it, you know, more user-friendly, I think that's one of the things we can do is, you know, have it at the fire hall. That way people that have never been to the fire hall get to the fire hall. You know, maybe a couple of firemen are there to ask questions and, you know, see what's going on there. One of the things involving the fire hall that hasn't come up is at one time, when the fire hall was built, I think we talked about phasing in a sound wall. I think when it was built, I thought we had told the neighborhood that we would build a sound wall behind it. And I haven't heard that come up in a couple of years. And so, you know, we got to find the money for that. If we did promise the neighborhood that we were going to build a sound wall, I think we need to follow through with that. And I mean, on the planning commission, I haven't heard anything since the fire hall was built, but I think that'd be one of the things that we can, you know, where are we at with that? Where are those funds coming from?
All right. Last question is, basically, is there anything else that you want to add based off of, you know, the six areas that we've listed below? Anything you want to add?
You know, I think that everybody knows that the city's role is to provide services. And I think during the budget process, if you look back and you look at the budget message for that year, there was some pretty ominous statements there where, you know, we were having a consultant say that we needed to watch carefully three funds: the general fund, emergency services, and streets. And I think what you saw through the budget process was, for the first time in my recollection, we had a line item discussion. I mean, we've had budget years in the past where it was done in two or three meetings. I mean, it was just boom, 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 right down the line, and it went out the door. I think this year, you know, there was a different mindset. It was time to sharpen your pencils and see where this money was going, line item by line item. And it was interesting, to say the least. I learned a lot, and much more so than when we just kind of rubber stamped it and sent it down the road. But, you know, I think that scrutiny is part of what we saw happening with the recall. Did we go too far? You know, I think we could have done some things differently. But I think the intent was a good one, was to somehow, you know, tell people that, yeah, we get it, times are tough. If you look at every other government entity that I know of, we're making cuts, we're going on furloughs, we're not buying equipment, you know, we're paying into our health care and everything else. And I think that was the message that the budget committee was trying to send the council and the citizens, was, look, we're in an economic situation here. Maybe it's not that bad this year, but we need to, you know, pull the reins in here and start making some cuts. I think some of our services have outlived themselves. And, you know, broadband at the time was a really good idea. I don't think anybody else offered broadband here. Maybe it's time to look at that again. I don't know how many of our folks use that service and what kind of hardship that would be if we were to slowly get out of it. I think the city cable TV, I think its time is come and gone. I don't have city cable, haven't had for years. Got very fed up with the reception, you know, and had 12 channels. Now I've got 250. And so I think that's another thing we really need to look at, is whether or not that's a service whose time has come and gone. Again, though, I don't want to, you know, we've got a lot of folks on fixed incomes, that's the only way they can do things. I don't want to make a hardship on anybody. But I think we need to take a good hard look at those things. I guess in closing, you guys all know me. I've been here forever. And you know what I'm like, and you know what I'm not. So what you see is what you get with me normally. And if you don't want to hear the answer, don't ask me a question.
Cindy Baseman.
And you look at the, you've gone over the list of questions.
Yes, I have.
And the actual ones with the hand that you can elaborate on. So you understand how
yes.
The question system works? Okay.
Yes.
All right. Here we go then.
Hi, Cindy.
Good evening. Lance.
In your application, you said that your vision for Cascade Locks in the next decade is that we will acquire new families as well as new businesses to our community. That our budget will be balanced as well as a vibrant fire department will be operating. What is the city's role in achieving that vision?
Thank you, Lance. The city's role, effective communication daily is so key. A balanced, well-maintained, functioning fire and emergency services, as I said, good communications daily with the city administrator as well as residents of our own town. Included would be continuing our excellent volunteer program, teaching people the skills necessary to be the best that they can in our fire department, bringing in more families, which of course will add growth to our town, stability, and new involvement to our city. Establishing new businesses, along with the key component, getting our charter school up and running. Having a well-balanced budget. Operating with a thriving and healthy, functioning city council. Also focusing on reasonable rates, city rates that we all, as residents, have to pay, along with the safe, growing, livable community and environment that new people will want to come and stay in our city. Also included is having the thriving Nestle's Bottling Company, which would be key to our town and growth.
Cindy, what is the role of city council in running the city? And what is the role of staff in running the city?
Well, number one, I believe there again, I'll reiterate, is having a positive city government that our townspeople can be proud about. I feel when more people are involved in suggesting new ideas to the council, they're getting their points across, they're sharing, I believe that is an important stepping stone to the positive growth that our city so desperately needs. We want, as we come to city council meetings, we want people to come and we want them to come again, over and over. We want them to feel welcomed, to come back. I think by working on a more positive setting, people will feel welcome sharing their fresh new ideas presented to council and to the public. We need to really focus on fresh solutions and not have those solutions or ideas fall through the cracks. Talk more about when new people come to our city council, talk more about those ideas that they're expressing. Also, by continuing to adopt ordinances, resolutions, policies, and regulations for the health, safety, and welfare of Cascade Locks.
Okay,
so Lance?
Yes. Okay, in your application, you also said that the most critical issues facing our community are balancing the city's budget, not backstabbing our city council, as well as other people in our community. It's okay to disagree, yet move forward in a positive direction together. What steps should the city take to resolve this issue?
I think it's really important to agree as we all have new ideas and ways of going through things, but also to agree to disagree. We need to have boundaries. We're all here, as I've heard before from the speakers, we're all a common goal is Cascade Locks in growing, having a thriving city council. I just think that we need to, I do get a little tired of a lot of people downgrading. You know, we're all here, we're doing the best we can. And so by going forward and carrying out the policies, I think that that's necessary and going forward. We are gonna have conflict. That's just a part of growth. But it's how we use that conflict in a more positive direction. And it's just key to getting along. As I said, it's okay to disagree.
All should the city council handle conflict, whether it be internal or external?
That's a great question, Tom. There's been plenty of research done on conflict management. As I said, a good solution would be stating boundaries within the city council to have everyone respect each other's ideas. We've all heard the saying, as I said, it's okay to disagree with one another. Possibly acquiring outside help for a few tools that we can use and utilize to learn the proper and healthy tools to get our points across and to solving the problems. But number one is the key component, and that's talking to one another. Because our actions pretty much magnify on, and everyone sees those actions, sometimes if they're not positive. So possibly getting a session from outside help could be a positive goal to work towards. If we can't resolve it amongst ourselves, council, city administrator, mayor.
So that's got your internal and external.
Externally, if I'd like to elaborate a little bit on that, would be getting more of the town involved in the solutions, listening to one another. But there again, you have to have an outlet. How are you going to get more input from the public here in our town? There's ways that we can go about doing that, and that's thinking outside of the box and maybe going into a discomforting level that we don't like to, possibly setting up a petition booth. I worked for Mount Hood Meadows for over 22 years, and one of the key issues at Mount Hood Meadows is people. Number one, without the people coming to the ski resort, we don't get paid. But they had information boxes situated certain parts of the two lodges. We could have one down at the Charburger with a simple comment card for the main residents to fill out. We could have one at the East Wind, or we could have one, I don't know if we could have one at the post office, but whereby we could, as I said, have a card, a simple comment card, and have people fill that out and come back and read them, getting new, fresh, external, outside input from people, from residents of our city.
What needs to happen in the city government in the next 12 months?
Well, number one key, as we've heard, is getting our fire station up and running, along with our volunteer training program. I would like to see, since the fire station isn't being utilized, why not put it to good use? Why not talk to some of the other districts that and have training sessions at our fire hall here? Whether it be the CPR has changed over the last couple years. It's not like the old CPR that we've probably grown accustomed to and are used to. Having classes at the fire hall. We have a large tower there. Why not utilize and have the classes for the firefighters to train there? Have a modest, possibly a modest fee for the usage of the fire station.
And then lastly, is there anything else that you want to add, you know, based off of the six areas that we have indicated at the bottom of the application?
Furthering communication with our residents of our town here, possibly by, we're all pitching pennies, saving money to eliminate postage and envelopes, get the residents' emails, send out what our important issues will be at some of our meetings, council meetings. Thereby, it's really key and important to get fresh, new input to our town, to our city council meetings. Possibly look at a larger area. I think I heard Brian talk about possibly setting up meetings, city council meetings at the fire hall, or go downstairs to the gym. We're so packed in here like sardines. People that feel free and possibly won't feel so claustrophobic would like a larger area. But we do need new growth. The town hall meetings down at the pavilion. As long as they're, again, it's great to have those because we need new input, but we need to have boundaries. We need to explain to them we can't downgrade anybody, council, mayor, city administrator, and there has to be a time limit. We can't have them talk for 20 minutes, whereby maybe 4 minutes, and then that way we'll get more involvement, we'll get new ideas that we can put and implement.
Great, thank you.
But I did want to comment too that I've been in this town for 23 years. I have a thriving residential business of 12 years. I've been a property developer, and I too really miss that unity that we had so much. I have a 17 and a 19 year old. They went to kindergarten here. And that's where we all connected. We kind of just all got together at the football, on the football field, within the basketball, the gym. And I do miss that, just that getting together. We're not so tense when we go sometimes down to the meetings. We get so, we're frustrated and we want to get our points across. But I too miss that unity that, and I hope and I know working in a positive manner that we're going to come back to that. And we're taking the right steps. And sometimes by what we went through the last 2 months, it's painful, but we're growing in a different, in a positive direction. And it hurts sometimes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm glad I was able to share that.
Linda Gross.
Same thing, you've looked at the questions and the follow-up information too?
But I don't have as long answers.
You know.
Okay.
Short to the point.
There you go.
Well, here come the questions.
Okay.
Hi, Glenda. In your application, you said that your vision for Cascade Locks in the next decade is to have a thriving community where we have businesses to create jobs that will in turn improve our tax base, which will improve our quality of services we can provide our citizens. What is the city's role in achieving that vision?
Well, I think we have to work to bring in jobs, and part of that would be working with the port. I mean, they have a much larger base than, I mean, the city does. And if we can work with the port to bring in businesses and offer them affordable electrical, a sewer, you know, water rates, so they can be more competitive. I think that's something that we all need to look at.
I know, I'm ready. And what is the role in city council in running the city, and what is the role of staff in running the city?
I look at the city council as making policies, making rules, so regulations, things like that, and for the, you know, the good of the people. I mean, this is our city, and I hope that the city council, you know, you do make those policies for us, and then the staff are the worker bees. I'm a staff member. I have the big wigs above me. And then I'm a worker bee. I'm the one that has to follow through with what my manager wants. And city council members are like managers. So your worker bees are following through with what you are proposing. And basically I feel, because I'm one of them, your staff projects, I mean, they see the city, the citizens come in, they talk, they, you know, they see the citizen, the staff sees the citizens more than the council does. So the staff is, you know, I'm not sure if I'm getting across. I just think that the staff holds, takes what you are suggesting and follows through with it, but they're the ones that handle everything. The staff handles everything that needs to be done, really, in the end.
Okay.
Yeah. Also, in your application, you said the most critical issues facing our community are the current issues would be funding the fire and emergency services without allowing our other needed services to suffer. What steps should the city take to resolve this issue?
I think that the city needs to look at the budget for the overall budget for the fire department and the emergency services, and to determine what level of services we can afford. Right now, it might not be a total program. I don't think that, I don't really know, because I've been caught up in family and work for the last years, and so I really don't know everything that's going on in the city or with the fire department, but I think that it's caused quite a, you know, an uprising. And I think that we need these services. They're very important to our city. But we also need to be able to fund them. And like I said, right now, without jobs and income, I mean, it might not be a full funding. You might not get to be able to provide all the services that the citizens want. And I think that maybe it would help to have a group of people look at the department and, you know, just find out where we stand. We need to serve, we need to fund it, but it might not, right now it might not be to the full extent. Even though it would be nice, but until you get more tax base and more money coming in, you know, you can't borrow from one to feed another without giving back to that other one. Does that make sense?
So, how should the city council handle conflict, internal and external?
It seems like there's been a lot of conflict lately. You have to be able to listen. You know, everybody has their opinions. I have very strong ones. That's what's, you know, gotten me through life and everything else. So you have your beliefs, but you also have to be able to listen and work with other people. In my job, where I work, we work as a team. Because what I might not be able to give to the circumstance, somebody else can, and you have to be able to listen to everyone's suggestions and then pull them together and for the good. I mean, we are here to serve the people, so you have to be able to determine and get along. I mean, like I said, I have strong opinions on things, but I also have the ability to open my mind and listen to suggestions so that you can handle things, you know, to get to the final outcome. And externally, I think a lot of people don't know the facts. I don't know the facts. I've lived in this town for many, many years, and I don't know the facts. People externally, it's like a landslide. Somebody says something that might not be true, but it's taken way out of context. And so we have to get the facts to the people. So then they can understand what's going on. Then you don't have this butting of heads. You can work together. But I do feel that the true facts need to be stated externally to come to together to accomplish what you need to accomplish.
Okay. So what needs to happen in city government in the next 12 months?
Well, we need to get jobs. I think that we need to pursue the Nestle Corporation to the fullest extent. I mean, they are a viable means of bringing jobs to Cascade. And doing that, we need to work with them to help make it affordable for, I mean, they're looking at us quite strongly. We need to do everything we can to help them so they can help us. By bringing Nestle in, you increase your tax base. So then you can supply more services. Once you get that tax base, then you get to look at your fire department and your EMS to where they can get more funds. But right now, I mean, they are something that we really need to pursue. And
Glenn, lastly, we have six areas here. Is there anything that you want to add? All of it?
Well, I've lived here for 52 years. I grew up here. I went to school here. I graduated. I married my high school sweetheart. I raised two daughters. I have five grandchildren that live here. The school was very big, and still is, but not as large of a draw. That is where this community gathered. If you didn't do anything, you went to the school. You went to games. You participated in everything. I mean, I come from a family of volunteers where we my dad was the fire chief. My brother was the fire chief. My mom worked at the potlatch. My husband and daughters and I all worked at the school to keep it here. And we've lost it, and so we need to work as a city to bring back that, bring something back to the city to where we need a gathering spot. We need something to unite around, and that was our school. I don't know much about the charter school or how to, get involved in that, but if that's what we need to do, we need to bring that back, and that will help our whole city, I think, our community.
Thank you.
And thank you for your consideration.
Sure.
Richard Randall.
Thank you.
So, once again, here, you've seen the questions that kind of left ones. So you ready to go here?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Or I guess I'll ask this.
Yeah.
Yeah, all right.
Hi, Richard.
Hi, how you doing, Mark?
Good. In your application, you said that your vision for Cascade Locks in the next decade is to have the city government in a position to provide all the necessary services to protect and grow this community economically, that you understand and support the private free enterprise market and will do what you can to help make local businesses successful, that we need to look at our current downtown economic development plan and see what we can do to encourage and give incentives for investors to bring new and innovative businesses into our community, and that we need to look into softening any fees and ordinances to encourage economic growth. What's the city's role in achieving that vision?
We need to, I'll start with the emergency services. We need to continue to rebuild the emergency services with an action plan that can be put together with the cooperation of the council, city staff, committees, and professional advisors until a point is reached where we can renegotiate our mutual aid agreements. That's one of the top priorities that we need to try to put back together. With my experience in emergency services, I would like to help whenever I can during that process of rebuilding in any way, shape, or can. Even if it's just, encouragement, getting to know people involved, and maybe even doing some research, because I enjoy doing research, and I do a lot of different things like that. So jobs, we need to continue to work alongside the port in the planning process as needed. We need to assist the port whenever we can to help bring in new businesses, obviously. Continue to diversify our economic plan to accommodate light industry and tourist-related industry side by side. I think that's the wise thing to do. We need to continue to look at softening any fees for services and possibly building ordinances to encourage economic growth. I know just in the past I've heard of different investors making comments that there wasn't anything really, there wasn't much incentives at all for them to come in here, meaning that a lot of the other industrial sites and people are in control of them, of course. Some cities are in control of some of the industrial sites, because obviously they all live by a waterway. That's what a lot of them do. They try to figure out a way to entice investors in and give them incentives, and I don't see any at this point that maybe we should look at. That might be one way to encourage people to take a good hard look at our community. The divided community, that's what it seems where we're at, sort of, and I'm extremely concerned about what's happened in the past, the highly charged politics, within our community, and I think that we need to do what we can to get through the divisive politics, and with compromise, focus on what we can do to bring opposing ideas together, views and opinions together, so we can solve the current problems. I will do whatever I can to help heal and bring the democratic process back into focus for the common good of everyone that lives here in this community. A lot of times, like I've heard before, just simply agreeing to disagree is a starting point a lot of times. That's what we need to do. Find and encourage common ground. Mutual interest alone has the potential of uniting people together that we normally wouldn't interact together. And all of us in here tonight, there's something that each and every one of us have in common. We might not know what that is, but that's just one simple thing that we can do to help bring people together. A good example is, unfortunately, the school was part of the glue that helped hold this community together, and was really unfortunate where we're at with the school, and I think the city needs to do whatever possible to encourage that process along and to bring it back together and do whatever it can to intervene every time it can to help forward that process.
And Rick, what is the role of city council in running the city, and what is the role of staff?
The role of city is to set policy, obviously. Council is obviously the legislative and policy body for the city, and they're charged with providing overall leadership and vision for the city to ensure the integrity of the process. The council should absolutely guide the process. I'm not saying micromanagement, but that has to do with leadership. The staff, like what was mentioned before, I'm a little nervous. I'll cut through that. The staff is charged with carrying out all the services of the city. And to follow all state, federal, and county regulations and all the state statutes, and also to follow the leadership of the council and the guidance of the council.
Okay, Richard, you may have touched on some of these issues already, but I'm going to ask the question anyway. In your application, you said that the most critical issues facing our community are no emergency services, no real jobs, and a divided community.
Yes.
What steps should the city take to resolve those issues?
Need to, like you say, a lot of these questions and my answers are all kind of intertwined, so I'm basically going to answer the question. I'm going to jump ahead and answer the question about what the city needs to do in the next 12 months, if that's okay.
Sure, yeah. Or you can wait for it, either one.
Yeah. We need to put together a plan on enlarging and updating the council chambers, whether that's moving the location or enlarging what we have, updating, all the equipment that's used, the audio and video, and that's one thing that we all know, that it's such a small place, and it's kind of not conducive to really conductive atmosphere for people to really come together in a more positive way. I mean, it's so small and cramped in here, and it's really difficult. I know this is something that I think that you are looking at. So, but I would continue to encourage to figure out a way that you can do that, because there is a lot of good ideas out there on what we can do to fix that. We need to have an action plan put together for the emergency service so we can renegotiate mutual aid as soon as possible. Maybe we can lease the old fire station, even though it hasn't been condemned yet, so it can be used. I know a lot of people have looked at it, and it is possible to lease it out and use that money that we get from that lease, obviously, for maybe one of the other critical services that need the money for. That'd be something that we can do. Our school, needs to happen. Our school, we need to keep focusing on that and get that together. All the services now operated by the city are essential or wanted by the community and needed for economic development, obviously, and have to be stabilized before any other services the city may need for, or before we can consider bringing any other services on board. We need to be able to stabilize what we have. Leasing the fire station is one way to help fund some of that. I imagine we will continue to struggle paying the bills until the day comes. The services will be self-sustaining, or we may have to ask the citizens for a vote to come up with some type of increase. But we need to do everything we can first to be as innovative and look at individual items on the budget like that they started this last year. I think that was very productive, but I think that, like it was said earlier, that maybe the swing of the pendulum went too far in the opposite direction, and a lot of things were happening that people aren't aware of. And I think that communication is the biggest part of anything that we do. We need to figure out a way to make sure that people understand what's happening, where we're going, and what the vision is of everything that we do. And I think that earlier on this year, I think that was probably overlooked. It helped get us in the situation.
Okay. Anything else?
How should the city council handle conflict, internal and external?
Internally, ideally, whenever possible, they should discuss conflicts internally before going public with a solution or remedy when that need is called for. But externally, there's a acronym that I have to use at work, and it's called WAS, and that's for external management. It's first, when somebody has a conflict, you have to believe what they're saying first. You have to listen to them, and then you have to apologize for any inconvenience or misunderstanding that may have been done on your part, and then try to solve the problem. And then after you go through that process of trying to solve the problem, then you thank everybody for their cooperation and trying to resolve the conflict.
Great. And then lastly, there are six areas down here that there are six areas down here.
One more photo. Okay, because he tied his three and that's probably the problem.
I'm sorry to confuse that. No, I tied a couple of them.
Yeah. The next question was basically what has happened in the next 12 months. But I think
okay.
You.
Okay. Yeah, I have that. I did. I already went through.
You covered that in?
Yes, about the action plan for the other emergency services. So
okay.
We can get the momentum going so we can get them mutual grade. When we get to that point as soon as possible, so we get the mutual aid agreements back and go out and agreement with the surrounding communities. I'm sorry.
Okay, that's good.
Okay. We'll adapt. So lastly, we have six areas down here that can be discussed. Is there anything that you want to follow up with or anything you want shed light on?
I think I probably covered most of my concerns. I'd like to talk real briefly about the town hall meetings and the different ideas for communicating with the public and getting citizens to be involved. And I know we do a pretty good job with Channel 23 and such. I don't know. I know everybody, a lot of people work Monday through Friday and the council meetings are on Tuesday. But I know some cities have council meetings, but before the council meetings, sometimes they have like a little reception or like a little time for people to get together just to just have a friendly gathering to kind of break the ice and talk over things over like that. Sometimes they even have guest speakers before the meeting. For example, I know there's a lot of celebrities that are involved with cities. I mean, a good example is Portland. They use the basketball team, which is an example. I don't know if that would even be feasible, but I think it'd be fun if we could have somebody come in here, very energetic, that loves to try to encourage people, to motivate people, that has a heart for kids, for example, come in and talk to everybody at 6 o'clock that's willing to come out. That might be one way to get people more involved, is to have it just kind of open it up a little bit and give people a reason to come here besides what's been happening the last 6 months. Something more positive and upbeat. I think that would be really awesome. Yeah, I'll come to the council meeting so I can listen to the basketball players first. No problem. That'll bring them in.
And those basketball players aren't doing anything right now.
I have a lot of good ideas, so I'll just keep rambling, but maybe I'll have an opportunity in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Cody Steelman.
Okay, so you see all the questions?
Yes, I have.
Okay, so you're ready to go there.
I'm ready to go.
Okay, man.
Hi, Cody.
Hey.
In your application, you said that your vision for Cascade Locks in the next decade is that the community of Cascade Locks is a city where other cities bordering us have to compete with us for industry, citizens, and tourism, where government implements sound fiscal policies, where oversight and accountability are demanded, where citizens can function in harmony with a government built on the respect of the rule of law. What is the city's role in achieving that vision?
Well, it's enacting legislation based on the rule of law, which is open and transparent with the people, business, and other agencies. That's it. I'll be more explanatory with some other answers, so we don't cover the same thing twice.
All right. Well, on to number two, then. What's the role of city council in running the city, and what's the role of staff?
Well, council, under our former government being council, city administrator, former government. The council legislates policy. It also has a quasi-judicial function as well. It directs the city administrator to deal with any role of the staff. Now the staff follows the direction of the city administrator, which follows the direction of the council. And they all comply with the employee manual to try to put the city in the best frame of mind for the people is a good example. Okay.
And then the staff?
The staff follows the direction of the city administrator, applies to the employee manual.
Okay, Cody, in your application, you also said that the most critical issues facing our community are that we have an emergency service department that is broke. We have roads that are in disarray. We have utility rates which create financial hardships for the citizens and raise the cost to do business here above our neighbors, so cost of living jobs just set up shop in our neighbors' towns. We have lost our middle and high school and are just holding on to our elementary school. We have outdated and unlawful ordinances and resolutions, and as much as we hate to admit it, we had some unlawful management which occurred that must never occur again. As a matter of fact, it seems everywhere we turn we have a critical issue, because with every administration came personal political agendas. This must stop and be prevented in the future by enacting new oversight legislation. What steps should the city take to resolve these issues?
Well, I'm going to bundle them all into one here. And when you get an audit report like this, it tells you we have a problem. So I'm going to take a quote from the statement from the United States Government's Accountability Office concerning government auditing standards report GAO 07-731G. And it says, the concept of accountability for use of public resources and government authority is key to our nation's governing process. Government officials entrusted with public resources are responsible for carrying out public functions legally, effectively, efficiently, economically, ethically, and equitably. Government managers are responsible for providing reliable, useful, and timely information for accountability of government programs and their operations. Legislators, government officials, and the public need to know, one, whether government manages public resources and uses its authority properly and in compliance with laws and regulations. Two, government programs are achieving their objectives and desired outcomes. Three, government services are provided effectively, efficiently, economically, ethically, and equitably. And four, government managers are held accountable for use of their public resources. So where do we start? The Office of the Budget, Finance, and the direction of the President's Auditor's Report created what something called, it's right here, this CRI, Cooperative Auditing Resolution and Oversight Initiative. This was the explanation for it. What it is tools to financial administration and monitoring tools and a risk assessment monitoring tools. It plays a pivotal role in preventing and resolving all audit findings and oversight issues. It helps identify underlying causes and the findings and empowers the people who know programs best to chart a course for program improvement. The Cooperative Audit Resolution Oversight Initiative CROI provides today's government officials with a concrete tool to improve programs and address fiscal and problematic challenges. CROI is twofold. One system is for the administration, as I pointed out, and one system is for risk assessment. But in looking at the administration section, we feel as we are not in compliance with the law. Let's look at the first question right here in internal controls. It says, please briefly describe the segregation of responsibility to provide an adequate system of checks and balances. Please attach any written policy or procedures that has been deployed. Well, we cannot do that here because we are not in compliance with budget law in this city. Budget law states right here, OAR 15.294.3521A, for the purpose of this rule, fund means a fiscal and accounting entity with self-balancing accounts to record cash and other financial resources, related liabilities, balances, and charges, all segregated for specific regulated activities and objectives. So, to start with, we need to go through our ordinances and our resolutions. We have fire department, for example, we have ordinance 361. What ordinance 361 did is, I'll read why it repealed. It repealed the creation of the fire department, setting forth their powers and their duties. It repealed our ambulance department, all their powers and duties. It repealed emergency radios, which could come into effect with our 911 system. It also repealed our ability to establish furnishing fire protection to residences and businesses outside the corporate city limits, the Cascade locks. It repealed a
resolution establishing a policy for compensation of volunteers. They repealed a resolution establishing policies concerning city fire protection to Dotson and Warrendale area. It repealed a lot. Everything that I do with our fire department, and it repealed anything further just in the language of this ordinance. But we need to rebuild that, right off the bat. We have many tools that we're not using in statute where we can bill for services we haven't been billing for. Some of them are search and rescue, out on the interstate freeway, everywhere but in our own city limits. So, another thing we have to do is we have to work orders. We have to log mileage and depreciation for our vehicles. We have to, any kinds of drugs. For the fire department, for example, parts inventory we have got to do. We have got to do equipment depreciation, especially for the high charge stuff that we're not doing. Because without it, we're never going to know our return on sales, our return on investment, our return on equity, our return on common equity, our return on capital, our weighted average cost of capital, our return on capital employed, our earnings before interest and taxes, return on invested capital, return on net assets, return on net worth, or any of the other returns that we need to know to figure out what we're doing in our city. It is a business, and we need to run it like a business. And that's where we start. We can have goals for anything future, but until we find out what we have to work with, we're not going to know what we can do in the future.
So, how should the city council handle conflict, internal and external?
Well, you need to be open, transparent, and avoid personal political agendas. Be as honest as you can with the people and with your own council. Another thing I might want to bring up, do not do any, when the people know that there's a conflict in the law, the people pretty much know it. I can pull an example here of a franchise fee or a privilege tax, which we had an legal opinion before it was done. They said it was a no-no, yet it was done with a payment in lieu of, which is the same thing as a privilege tax, and it's in conflict with the law. People knew it. When you do that, you bring on conflict.
So, external conflict?
Same thing. You've got to be open and transparent with the people.
Okay.
Honesty is your best policy.
What needs to happen in city government in the next 12 months?
Well, an overhaul of legislation and policies, making what is in the best interest of the city of the goal, not what's in the best interest of a personal or public agenda.
Tony, and then the last thing, we have six areas that we've established at the bottom.
Right.
And is there anything that you'd like to add?
I'll add on the fort and city. I think you both have a responsibility and a legal responsibility to create jobs. That's pretty much in the legislative law. That's one of the major functions of both these governmental bodies. And I'm disappointed on both sides. But I can't place blame on both sides because I can look at the port. They hold all the taxable, the best property in this town that's worth anything on our tax rolls. It needs to be on our tax rolls. But then again, I can look at the city that they're not helping to market it because of our utilities. They're still out of line with the rest of the marketplace. I know working for corporations, that's one of the first things that they're going to look at when they come in to a city is, what's it going to cost me to do business? And when you look at our high utility rates, that's raising their cost of doing business, so you're running them out of town. Then we also have other laws that have been brought up tonight, which are not productive for businesses and creating businesses here. you have to take the restrictions off the business as much as possible. We're a small town. We're not a big town like Portland that can afford to put all these restrictions on these businesses in our town. We're not. We need to grow our town, get our tax base up before we can even think about that kind of stuff. I mean, we may have a dream for what we want our town to look like and our downtown zone to look like, but when it costs businesses money to do it or to keep up with it, they don't do it. And they're not doing it now because of the hardship we're placing on business. We have to take that hardship away. Okay.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Bill Logue.
Short. So, Jeff, you've watched?
Yes, I have.
Okay, so where are you going?
Hang on a second.
I just want to say everybody's had some really great ideas, and it's just been interesting to sit through this process and be a part of that. A lot of my comments or my questions, the answers to the questions were partly in my original application, so instead of rehashing a lot of that, just in respect for your time and the citizens' time, you can kind of refer back to some of those. I think that's reviewing what was in there, but I do have some points to talk about and to answer the question specific. Most of my answers are very short for the first five. It's in the follow-up questions, the last six questions is kind of where I have some more answers to talk about. So they're not incorporated into the body of the questions, the first part of the body of the questions, like some other people did. Does that make sense? Okay.
Okay, Jeff, having said that, with respect to rehashing your application.
There we go.
In your application, you said your vision for Cascade Lodge for the next decade is the vision I have for this community requires blending the great plans our community's forefathers had with the emerging new ideals and goals of this current decade. I look forward to all members of the community uniting and in providing direction once again in collaboration. I see a vibrant downtown area filled with entrepreneurs, tourism year-round, new businesses on developed port property, providing a solid business base, and finally a healthy, friendly citizenry actively participating in hiking, biking, sailing, and all this area has to offer. I see this community embracing economic development and the city successfully partnering with the port to accomplish many of these aspirations. What's the city's role in achieving that vision?
The city's role in that vision to achieve that is to provide infrastructure. And infrastructure is pretty basic when it comes to city light water, all the things that it takes to require that run a city. Public safety is another thing that the citizens need, and it's part of our vision to have a safe community to move forward with that. And that not only talks about police, but fire and EMS. So the citizens believe that they're safe. And when they come here, they know if they call 911, they're going to get somebody that's going to respond quickly if they're going to be here. We have to look at the best practices. We have to look at other cities to see what helped them become successful. We don't have all the answers here, and I'll be the first one to admit in my job that I have, I don't always have all the answers, but I either know where to go to get the answers or who to ask. And you have to check, I guess somewhat your ego in a little bit, but you have to be able to sit down and realize that you're not gonna know all the answers and that you have to go ask for help to solve these problems. And that's done collaboratively. And we have to look within our community and outside of our community for those answers.
And what is the role of city council in running the city, and what is the role of staff?
The role of city council in running the city is to set policy and give direction to the city administrator. We need to take input from the citizens, and that's by building relationships with the citizens. You know, you may have a difference of opinion with those the citizens, but you have to take those the information in from them and put it together and move forward what's best for the community. We get that from public comment time. We will also get that from committees that give us recommendations on what they believe is the best solution to the problem. And they also get an opportunity to talk with the citizens to get that public input for that process. The job of city council is not to micromanage staff or the day-to-day operations of the city. One of the things we as a council, or the council needs to ensure, that we're hiring good quality, qualified staff and to retain that staff, because if we do that, the legwork at the beginning, when it comes to background checks and their reference checks, and we have those good people in place, we currently have good people in place and retain them, we will have a well-running city and we will avoid a lot of the issues that can come up with other cities in trying to retain staff.
Okay, in your application, you also said the most critical issues facing our community, most undoubtedly restoring trust in city government and ensuring city council will listen to its citizens, the very citizens it's intended to represent. Only when council makes sound decisions will the community have trust and faith in its leaders. Another critical issue facing the community is dissemination of true and accurate information about the city's financial state and its fiscal responsibility. Untrue or slanted information has created a vast divide in this community. And you said the most pressing critical issue that needs immediate attention is public safety. What steps should the city take to resolve those issues?
I have a question that was back towards you. Did I not answer the other question? Did I miss what the role of the city is, or is that did I skip ahead somewhere?
I think that you covered the council. I'm not sure.
So when I was reading the questions, the part of the question was, what's the role of city staff?
The city staff. Mm-hmm.
I didn't answer. I thought that was the next follow-up question.
Go ahead.
Okay. All right. Just want to make sure.
Staff, yeah. Okay. The staff then.
Okay.
You're going to go on the staff?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Am I messing up the order?
No. Let's repeat that.
Okay. The role of staff in running the city, staff takes direction from the city administrator, who gets direction from the council. And the city administrator runs the day-to-day operations of the city. More importantly, though, when the city administrator is providing that direction, he or she also receives input and problem solving from the staff, because the staff are the worker bees out there doing the job. They know how to do it more efficiently or have a better idea on how to do something, and that's that conduit of flow communication up, down, or up to top, back and forth, and that's the job and that's the teamwork environment that needs to happen. Even though there's a hierarchy of order, but it's a teamwork environment, it's problem solving. That's what we all supposed to do, is problem solve and go forward with the vision and make Cascade Locks a better place. Okay, now I'm back.
You hear the question again?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, so you said, I'm gonna summarize your answers. Okay. The most critical issues facing the city are trust in city government and dissemination of true and accurate information. The most pressing critical issue that needs immediate attention is public safety, and what steps should the city take to resolve those issues?
Restoring trust in city government, that's probably the biggest one, like I said. Trust is a perishable commodity. We must continue as a council to make deposits in that trust account. And the only way you make that accomplished is by making good, sound decisions based on good, sound information that you receive. And then the citizens will let you know that if they trust you or not by the way you're treated and the interactions are there. And that's the biggest part. That's a broader picture that we need to look at. Those decisions that we make and how we're making them affect all the citizens, and that's where you get the opportunity to listen to everybody and how we represent them. We need to work together in good faith for the community. We need to have a transparent process, let people see and understand that we understand what's going on in the community. The other part of that is public safety. Public safety is how we would show signs for trust, if we build up that trust that we're going to provide good sound government, good sound public safety for our citizens to keep them safe so they feel safe. We have to have the city administrator work with the area fire chiefs to restore pressing issue that's the most pressing issue that needs immediate attention is public safety, like we talked about. That is where we have the city administrator work with the area fire chiefs to seek guidance on repairing our fire and EMS services, with the end state goal being a full responding fire and EMS department, whether that's a paid part-time volunteer basis. That's up for the citizens to decide what they want. It was quite apparent earlier this year what people believed, and it was a heated event. And the other part of that is help reestablish our mutual aid agreements. And I think that's a huge thing because we can't do it all ourselves. We have to rely upon other people to help us, but they also need to be able to understand that we can help them. Right now, we're not able to help the other people. And so that's a big thing to show our partners in the Mid-Columbia Valley or the Western Edge that we are a community. It's just not bordered, we don't have a border of the Washington, Oregon. It's a Mid-Columbia Valley. It's a regional approach to this, and it's a force multiplier because we have to depend on our fellow cities and agencies for these things, not just fire EMS, but other things that are out there too for economic development. You know, we're coming into a new budget year and budget cycle, and we need to prepare for that. We need to ensure accurate information about our city's financial status and responsibilities are out there for the public, and it's transparent that there's no hidden agendas. The documents are there, and it's in a format that everybody can understand. Just not, I hate to use the term, but bean counters. If you're a bean counter, you can look at something and understand it better than a layman like myself when it comes to accounting.
How should the city council handle conflict, internal and external?
In my current profession, I've dealt with conflict resolution for 19 years, and I do it on a daily basis. Over the last 7 years, I've been in a management and leadership role. I've had to deal with internal and external issues where I work at, and the key is listening to all the sides. And you have to be able to listen. You have to take the emotional side out of the conversation, and it's tough sometimes to take it emotional, because sometimes you are being attacked, and it's an attack that's a personal attack either on your character or what's going on. And it's not, if you don't take it personal, you just open yourself up to listen to what's going on, you will see the world in a whole different level when you're looking at it, and you're going to be able to take in a lot more ideas when you just sit and listen and understand what goes on. If it's an internal or external, if it's an internal and we as a council are able to come to an understanding, we've heard it here before, but you know, it's one of the things, we'll agree to disagree sometimes. And it's okay to do that. At the end of the day, it's not, somebody hates me for whatever reason. We have a disagreement. We're big kids about it, not little kids. And I'm gonna go take my sandbox and go play somewhere else. It's, you have to be able to listen and do it collaboratively and remove those boundaries of a heated issue. And sometimes it's tough to do that. External, we have to be honest with people and let them know if we can or can't do something, not make false promises. And that helps with those issues there. But there are several ways to help resolve external issues and internal issues, but outside intermediaries, the League of Oregon City offers a lot of those classes. There's a lot of training that I think council members should go to, and at least if we could host that here and bring in other events or other cities into these events, you know, that helps us build training for our staff, training for us, and it helps also showcases our city and what the potential that's there to do that.
And what needs to happen in city government in the next 12 months?
We need to look for solutions for the fire and EMS department, public safety. That's always been my thing. Is public safety is number one priority. The citizens need to feel they're safe. The next thing is repairing the city budget and ensuring that we're doing things in a lawful manner. We also have to look at, because of what has happened with our EMS department, our revenues are going down. So we have to really look at those because the revenues that may have been projected coming in are no longer there. Also, another one is economic development. We need to bring new businesses in. We need to help shift the tax burden from the residential ratepayers to businesses. And by having that, they will pay a bigger share when the new businesses come in. We've heard Nestle Waters. There's a lot of other ideas that are out there that I think are very good and very viable for our community. But we need to get that input from the citizens. You know, I would love to see a development out in the port property where it's a joint business venture, a private joint business venture. You see a lot of those things going on in other cities. They capitalize on that, and there's a lot of private business out there that wants to invest in the government and have a partnership. And that's what it is, building a partnership and building relationships.
Six areas at the bottom here for you to add anything you'd like to add.
Well, we'll first talk about the city and port economic development. need to have joint meetings, joint goal settings. How does the city work with the port to track new businesses? What is our role? Our role is to provide, like I said, that infrastructure, being business friendly, providing incentives for businesses to be here. We need to work for the common good of the community, showing that this is a good place to live and raise our families. We heard about the school and all these other binding things that make us a community. We need to work on that, and the port can help with those. One of the things that we talk about, and it's in my job and a lot of other jobs, it's about relationships. Back in March of this year, I met a gentleman by the name of Patrick Singh. He was the aide to Representative Cowan, who was down in Salem. I was in Salem representing my organization on law enforcement events and giving testimony for a bill and giving input on a bill. And with that, he was asking me, he's one of our reserve officers, come to find out, he was asking me a little bit of guidance and, hey, you've been around the block a little bit in law enforcement, how do you think I should get my career if I want to go in law enforcement career? Develop that relationship, have conversations with him about that. Monday, August 15th, I received an email from Patrick Singh, who now is Ports Coordinator for the Business of Oregon Infrastructure Finance Authority. That relationship that I had with him, he saw me outside of Central Precinct when I was down there. Hey, Jeff, how's it going? Good, Pat, how are you doing? Had a conversation. He thought enough of me and the conversation that I had, and that small relationship that I built, that he said, hey, I would like to talk to you more about economic development in the Port of Cascade Locks. And the reason why I want to do that is I am now in charge of the finance portion of that. That could give us a foot in the door over another city, because we have a relationship with somebody. You have that. And so he invited me to attend the meeting, but it's going to be on a work day for me tomorrow. But tomorrow, the 25th of October, Senator Thomas and Representative Johnson and their congressional staff will be talking with the ports of Hood River and Cascade Locks. They'll be here in the Port of Cascade Locks about 3:30 to 5 p.m. Those are those type of things I can offer and bring into that with business relationships, because we all have different ideas and different ways of doing things, and we all have different relationships and know people differently. And having those relationships helps us as a community as a whole, because we take all the ideas that we have in these groups of citizens here and use them, and then we can use those ideas from outside too to help us. The next one is, what's the city's responsibility? Provide good basic services and be responsible to its citizens. That's part of that economic development. Finances, what do you see are the most important for the city to provide? Public safety, that's my mantra always, public safety is the first one. Infrastructure, you know, we need to have good water, clean water, we need to have sewage, you know, when we flush the toilet, it needs to go away, it needs to go down to the toilet down there by the river down there. And, you know, we're one of the oddities, if you will, where we have our own electric department. So we have to make sure our rates are in line with other rates. Those are all self-funding, so we don't really have to worry about those. It's the one that's not self-funding is the public safety. We have to figure out the tax dollars and where those are at. Looking at the, do we have to look at a fire district? Do we have to look at a fire authority for those, for the fire EMS? Those are questions we have to ask and we have to look at to see what's the best solution to solve our problem. It's going to take a lot of input. It's going to have some growing pains, but firing EMS doesn't need to be a political event. That needs to be separate, and that never needs to be a political event. You know, the services that we need to look at, you've heard it earlier, but the cable TV, you know, that's nice. Do we need to have it? Are we losing money on that? You know, HBO's raised its rates. So how do the taxpayers subsidize that? I don't think that's right, but we have to look at that. You know, the broadband, is it in line with other things, or are there other companies out there that offer better ideas? Sometimes park and recreation gets looked at and hammered and taken away from, but can we look to the port to partner with them? Also, there's other organizations out there, Big Brothers, Big Sisters, that can provide some of that stuff that we have a paid person for parks and rec. You know, those are those things we have to look at, and they're tough decisions right now. Those are niceties that maybe we can bring that paid position back, but we look for volunteers for that. It's tough now, it's a tough climate with, you know, trying to get volunteers engaging, but that's our job, is to get community engagement. And the more engagement that we have, the stronger our community is going to be. The tourism was listed down there. That's self-funded. That takes care of itself. That's provided. That's the transient lodging tax that pays for that. And those monies are decided. Tourism makes recommendations to council on how those monies needs to be spent. So that's kind of a neat point with that one. How are we doing financially, and what should be done differently? you know, as far as I knew and talking last talking to Marianne, the city's still solvent. However, with recent issues with the fire and EMS, you know, there's not, we're not going to have the projected income that's coming in. We're going to readjust those projections that are coming in. If we're underfunding anything, it might be that, or it might not have enough funding to fund that. So we have to look for creative solutions to take care of those. We've, like I said, talked about at great length fire district and fire authority. How do we reach out more to citizens? Town hall meetings. How do we involve our citizens to face all the issues? We're going to ask them for input. One of the things my organization's done is it's been web-based, and you have a opportunity where we log on our computers every day, they have a survey, and they ask us for these things. Pretty minimal cost. And so if we go away from paper type of surveys to web-based surveys, and you have to make sure that the surveys aren't loaded in the front end, so just one element gets to say we want this. It's, you do it through security measures like your account information from your billing on your electrical. They have to sign in with that and they have a password to do that. And if they've been selected for this survey, you have questions, you ask those questions. And you have a broader survey. If people aren't able to have get to the school or get to the library to log on to the computer, they can do it manually here, but it'd save on paper costs that way, because we're always looking for paper costs or paper way to save savings. And so that's one way to do it. People laugh, but you know, there's the Twitter accounts, there's Facebook, what's going on? You have those. We have to reach out to, you have a generation here that has never had a computer, to where they kind of get it in their phone. And you have generations that communicate just, I mean, I see it downtown, these kids are just going down with their thumbs and typing faster than I can with all 10 fingers. And so you have to be able to use your technology that's out there to get to the citizens to have them. Next is how you arrive at the consensus. We have to do that by listening to all the ideas, and then you meld them together. You walk away at some point knowing that you may not please everybody, but if it's good for the citizens, if it's good for the communities, that's what the end goal is. You need to have meetings in larger places. It's been talked about Fort Pavilion, Fire Hall, down at in the gymnasium. It's a confining environment. We want to make it friendly. You've heard a great bunch of great ideas on that. So how do we determine the will of the people? You listen to the citizens, you get out and meet them, you build the relationships with them. It may be uncomfortable for us. You have to have those town halls, have those gatherings with the citizens and be able to do that. One of the other things we talked about was the budget, asked about was the budget. How should the council do its job in the oversight of the budget? We're doing that right now, but make sure that people that are being appointed to budget committees for the right reasons have an interview process and look for people that have experience in that. And there's an untapped resource out here in our community that we need to look at to utilize. The city council is doing a good job. They might have tweaked some things. The city council is the center of the budget process. Council members show up to budget and with the budget committee members, and they get the input. So if everybody's doing their jobs like they're supposed to, you're going to have a good grasp of what's going on and what the people want to do if you're doing it right. You might need an independent review or an audit of what goes on in the budget right now to see exactly where we're at. One of the questions was asked, how do you think we should challenge experts to make sure we're getting a good cascade lock solution? You know, it's a good solution, but we need to do our homework in the front end, like I talked about when we hire these experts, when it comes to attorneys and city administrators, get the look of them, what they are, before they sign on the line and sign the contract with us, so we know what we're getting. And we have to be willing to listen to subject matter experts. We may challenge them at times, but they're the subject matter experts and we have to listen to them. The last part of this is, what do you think will make a successful city council for Cascade Locks? Listen, one of the things that I do, it's a litmus test when we make decisions. Is it good for the citizens? Is it good for the city? Is it good for the individual or the situation? If it meets those three, it meets that muster, it's an easy decision to say yes on. If it only meets two of those, you have to question that and understand if it's actually good for the community, if it meets all those three. You know, as council members, we need to attend training that's offered and apply that training to our job here on the council. There's good foundation for what's going on. You just need to build upon. Thank you for your time. I hope I wasn't too long-winded.
Thank you.
So, is that everybody?
Everybody.
Okay, so third part of our agenda is fill vacancies. Are we into filling those tonight, or personally, we got a lot of information from. I've got a lot of good people that have put in applications, and we got a lot of information from them. I don't know if tonight I'm ready to make those decisions. I took a lot of notes, so it seemed like I was ignoring you out there when you were over here. I was just taking notes, trying to keep up with all the information you were giving us. But, how do you guys feel on the process of filling the vacancies?
Well, I've done, I've looked at some stuff, but I would certainly like at least to have a few minutes to think before I would have to make some decisions. Sorry.
How about you, Lance?
I think it's important that we move on with city business and that we make these appointments. I think we have an open and transparent process here, and part of that process was that we make our determinations tonight. So I'm not opposed to taking a break. It's been 2 hours. But I think important thing is that we follow through with the agenda and fill the vacancies tonight. I think there's some questions about that process that should probably be answered first, but I'm ready to do that tonight.
So, questions, why don't we take a break? We'll ask about get our questions on that process when we come out of that and go from there.
And your break will be for how long?
I'd like to have 10 or 15 minutes.
Let's go, we're still in pretty good shape. We'll go 15, so that gives us a chance to
give
you a chance to eat some absorb this stuff if we're going to head towards full of vacancies. Yeah.
It'll be about 9:20.
Sounds good. 9:20.
Look at the clock.
Sorry, I need to do.
I think a break is.
Fill the vacancies. So we've got three counselors to fill and a mayor. So the mayor will be the last one to fill. So we've got two counselors and basically the mayor. We're looking at just over a 1 year term. Their terms go till 12/31/12. Two counselors and the mayor. Another counselor position goes to 12/31/14. So one person's got a couple more, 3 years, got almost 3 years, a little over 3 years, and three positions have just over 1 year. So we'll, the way I've got them listed here is first two are just over 1 year, third position is just over 2 years, and then the mayor's position. So we'll take nominations for the first position, which term will end 12/31/12.
Can I step back for a moment? there's something that I wanted to discuss, and that is that kind of when we go, and I've discussed this with Paul, and we checked with a lawyer a little bit, and my understanding in when we were going through this process is basically that we would kind of fill the council positions, and we'd fill all the positions, and then we would vote on a mayor. And of course, I'm kind of the diplomatic person, so I like that a lot better than just three people picking who's going to be the mayor. The charter, in my opinion, is pretty loose on the subject, and so I wanted to talk about that because we didn't really. Because my understanding of the process is different than what it is now. My thought was that it would be like you'd be the council, and then the council would decide who was going to be mayor. So
fill three positions, and then those they're not council members until they're
right.
Sworn in.
Mm-hmm.
So we swear them in right now that the mayor, or we wait for a length of time for the mayor?
Well, I don't know. That's why I'm talking.
So that's where I assume that's where we're at. We have once we pick, they're not council members until they're sworn in.
Right. So I don't know exactly the thought process, I think, on that, but I just know that I feel that I would be much more comfortable with us having more people to determine that. And I understand, so Alex has stated that, and we talked with Paul about what the charter says. Do you have the charter with you?
I do.
Could you read that off? And because it kind of talks more about like one position, but we have four that we're dealing with, and I definitely don't want to do anything that's illegal. However, I do want to, I just think that diplomatically, that's more people that are deciding who's going to be a mayor. So that's why I just bring the question up.
Yeah, you're talking about Section 30, filling of vacancies, and it says, council vacancies shall be filled by a majority of the remaining members of the council. The appointee's term of office shall begin immediately and shall continue until the next general election, and the term for that position shall be the unexpired portion of the remaining term.
Okay. There's another issue that came to light, and that is that we didn't anywhere in our process have anybody determine whether they wanted to be, whether they were applying, what position they were applying for. So,
yeah.
Well, to me, we set up an open, transparent process. We've gone through that process now, and the way I understood it was, this is a process where we appoint four people, and then those four people, at that point, would determine who's going to be the mayor. That's, to me, that's the process that we created, and we actually specifically asked for the information that we received today a week ago, and we specifically asked to have it, and this is the legal interpretation, we specifically asked to have it before tonight's meeting. So it makes me really uncomfortable to get this information on the night of a meeting, right before the meeting, and since it's information that changes the whole process in my mind. And so it just, it raises questions to me about the nature of this particular interpretation of our charter. It seems somewhat capricious to have been asked for it a week ago and then only to get it to us tonight. And so I just want to make it clear, if we're going to change the process from what we decided on originally, and we need to know why we need to have a clear and open explanation of why we're changing that process. So, and I've looked at the charter. I spent a year on the charter review, or years on the charter review committee, and so I'm familiar with this particular. I mean, it's this section 30. It's you know, potential changes. What it really means have been debated back and forth on that committee. You know, the first sentence says council vacancies are filled by a majority of the remaining members of council. And how we were told to interpret that was that we would determine the process, which is what we did. Only then tonight, just before the meeting, we were told, well, wait a minute, there's this other thing that you have to do that you're not allowed to determine. And I just have to, I mean, I have some serious questions about how that interpretation came down, because it does say that council vacancies are filled by a majority of the remaining members of council. That's all it says on how the vacancies are filled. Now there's another sentence that talks about the term of office. That's the subject of the next sentence. But the first sentence of section 30 talks about filling vacancies. And the agenda item that we are at this meeting is filling vacancies. It doesn't say anything about term of office on this agenda item. So, you know, my preference is that we stick with the process that we established. It's been an open, transparent process all along, and to change it at this point, you know, right at the last minute, I mean, it raises some questions about the openness and transparency.
Well, I don't think I totally understand what you're saying on it, because all this says is the term of office. It says we're going to fill positions. There's four positions here that's open. We're going to fill those four positions. I mean, what's different? What did we change?
It's like what Evan just said.
Yeah, it's just a matter of, you know, determining there. In my thought process, when I was going through the process, I was thinking that we were going to, we would fill positions, and then we would, as a council, decide who's going to be mayor. So that's what the question is.
So the question is then, not so much in filling positions, it's how we're going to fill the mayor position.
Correct.
Is that?
That, yeah.
That's a change in it. Of whether we're going to fill that position, or whether the, everybody we bring in fills that position. Is that your question on it?
No, that we take a.
I understand yours. You're saying you want everybody. Are you saying?
I'm saying that was the process we established.
Us three are also picking the mayor from the process that we established.
What I agreed to when I agreed to establish in this process was that we would fill four positions, and that once those people were sworn in, they would now have seven. They would select a mayor from among the group, which is also what Eva is saying. So to me, to do it this way, where three people determine that position, is a change in the process, and I really don't think it should be done that way when we've gone all along doing it a different way.
Okay.
And we've been developing the process.
I've got no problem with that. So, we're all good with that then.
Mr. Presiding Officer, let me either confuse the issue. I think everybody is in agreement that there are some vagaries in your charter. But let me suggest you try this. You have a number of people who are here from your community. Why don't you ask that question of them? And then if you feel comfortable and you desire to appoint four people to fill vacancies, do it under the understanding that when those people are sworn in, then the first order of business for the new full-seated council is to select somebody to finish out the term for the recalled mayor. And I don't have any idea what your citizens would think about that approach, but I think it would be fair to ask them.
I would agree with that.
So.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, having been the mayor, I'm also a little bit familiar with the process, and my understanding was, and I thought the best process would be fill the four positions as required according to the charter, and then have the entire newly seated council determine among themselves and vote among themselves who, that is the way it's done in every other committee in the city. The committee is formed, and then the committee determines the person that they believe should be chair. And I believe that's the way the mayor should be done, is the people that you feel are worthy to be seated as councilors should decide who they believe is worthy to run the city.
I concur.
Okay.
Does anybody have a?
The entire council should.
Cody?
Yeah, I believe if you look at ORS chapter 221, you're going to find that a mayor must have served on the council before they can be a mayor. Also to confuse the issue a little bit more, I've asked the city for an answer on a question I have concerning the constitutionality of us appointing a government. We have a council sitting here that does not have a quorum under the law. A quorum is one more than half. So under the state law, it says that you cannot do any city business without a quorum. So if the Constitution of the United States, Article 4, guarantees us a republic form of government, which means the power of the people by the vote of the people, I wonder if this whole process is constitutionally legal.
According to past practice is there has been several mayors who have not been council members previously. So according to the city's own past practice, then that would mean that would not preclude somebody from.
Well, I think
we're
standing.
Okay. Okay. Hold up your second. Yeah. Let me get some control there.
Mr. Presiding Officer, there never is a requirement at almost any level. I mean, anybody. Well, I'll pick on Brad again tonight. If Brad wanted to run for Congress and we wanted him up there, it wouldn't make any difference if he had served there or not. There is no requirement that you serve on the council before you get elected mayor. Any citizen can do that.
I disagree. Georgia state law says in ORS chapter 221, subchapter 700 to 900, somewhere in there, it says to serve as a mayor, you must serve on council first. We have not done that in accordance to the law. I think it's time that we start following in accordance to the law. I would have no problem if there's no constitutional issue that I've already raised and haven't got an answer to, that we appoint this mayor if there's no constitutional violation here. But I think that we need to do it in accordance with Oregon state law, because it's not specified in our charter to give us any exemptions from the state law. To have an exemption for state law, we have to have it in our charter. There's a ruling in LeGrand that says that if there is a state law and we don't address it in our charter, that state law rules in that instance.
Thank you. So, but you know, I guess from my opinion, our lawyer's been aware of what we're doing here. The lawyer hasn't, that I know of, has challenged where we've been heading on this thing. And I think that our charter does. Our charter basically says you can appoint anybody, any position that's gone, you can appoint. Our charter does say something.
It does address a vacancy. Not a government. You're appointed a government.
Well, that's the vacancy.
Not a vacancy in the council. You're appointed a government here.
That's all the difference. Okay, well, I appreciate that.
Again, yes, Mr. Presiding Officer, I would again go back to the citizens. The specific section says council vacancies. And I think we could sit here all night long and debate this. If it is the desire of the three of you to appoint people to fill those vacancies, and after you're all seated, then select who gets to be the mayor, then I proceed with that. Remember, the attorney's job is to give you a legal opinion. Your charter is the guiding principle, and you just generally fall under the Constitution of the United States.
Well, sounds like to me that everybody's okay with getting the four appointed, and then from that, square them out. You can swear him in, can't you?
I believe I can, but I'd want to make sure that I could.
Okay. Well, then, so we may not get to the point of having a mayor tonight, then. Because I do think that everybody has to be sworn in at least to be able to get to the point where they can, where they can vote on. Well, they'll certainly have seven people.
Isn't that normally done by council, by legal council?
Is what done by legal counsel?
No, it's normally done by justice of the peace.
It could be a notary public.
Normally. It always has been.
Typically done with the judge.
Yeah, we usually have the judge, but if they want to do it quick tonight, move on, and we can do that.
Or if we don't do it tonight, couldn't we do it some night later on this week?
We have to do it. Well, they want to do it quick, so as soon as we can make a meeting.
We can do it at the next meeting. Very first thing.
Could we do a special thing like this week?
If you want to have another meeting with a couple of days to make the mayor, let's do it. Wait. Want to do it quick? Get her moving.
That's fine with me.
Yeah. Okay. So we're going to choose four people. We won't be choosing the mayor tonight. But I believe we'll try to set the meeting as quick as we possibly can to be able to choose a mayor. So now, but again, part of it is there are terms. That's going to stick in there. Three of the appointees are going to have just over a year. One of the appointees, which is going to be a council person, the mayor just has over a year. One of the appointees is going to have just over 2 years. Yes, Lynn?
I'll make a motion that we appoint Mark Storm to the term ending December 31st, 2014.
one? The one that two?
Well, I was kind of looking at just putting out nominations out there.
Well, the appropriate way to do it is a motion and a second.
Through a motion and a second, okay. You don't want to put out a number of nominations and just vote on the nominations?
You mean the, I'm not understanding.
So there's a nomination on the floor that needs a second.
Okay.
Well, it's a motion, yeah.
Okay, I just want to throw one thing in here. Can I do that? If we're going to do the mayor that way, would we need to also do the one term that's longer, or, because we didn't really talk about that. Or can we nominate for those?
We can nominate for those.
Okay.
So we're going to nominate all four of them here.
Well,
one of them tonight's going to be one that's going to have just over two years. So we're going to nominate a person for over 2 years.
Okay.
Okay, so we have.
I'll second.
All right. So it's been a motion seconded to nominate Mark Stone for position one.
For the term ending December 31st, 2014.
2014, okay, yeah, two years more. So. All in favor?
Do we want to have any discussion? Or?
Oh, okay. Do you want to discuss? Yeah, let's go discussion.
Well, I haven't gone through this process before, guys,
okay.
So. I just wanted, I guess as far as discussion, I felt that there was a lot of good things that he said, encompassed a lot of the ideals that I kind of hear people talking about, what they're looking for in council, and you know, what we're looking for.
Any other discussion?
Well,
yeah.
You know, as the maker of the motion, my thought is, here's a person whose emphasis is on cooperation and building a positive future for the community. And in my mind, that's exactly what we're looking for. Along with a lot of specific ideas.
Mm-hmm. That's what I was going to say, very multifaceted ideas, being ideas that were positive.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Oh, there was one. My wife.
Okay, Mark Storm, you're in.
I'd like to nominate Jeff Helfrich.
Is that a motion?
That's a motion. A motion?
Okay. I second.
Okay, discussion.
When I looked at Jeff's information and I listened to what he had to say, again, we're looking for open communication, lots of ideas at ways to make things better, looking at ways to foster environments where we're listening to all sides. There's a lot of experience. And you know, there's a lot of structure and good ideas. Yes.
Again, I feel like here's a candidate who has extensive background in conflict resolution and community building, as well as a positive outlook for the future growth in our community. And to me, along with a lot of specific ideas, that's what we're looking for in a city council person.
On my end, I've been on the council, but not for up around going on 5 years now, and been involved with Jeff in several meetings. And Jeff, and there's a lot of good input from lots of people, including Jeff. But in my experience with Jeff, it doesn't always follow through with some of the ideas and things that are going on here. So I, from my side, I can't support this, even though it shows lots of good information in there. But from my experience, it hasn't followed through on all of that. So, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Aye. So, that's position one is Jeff. I'd like to nominate Linda Groves.
A point of order.
Yeah.
Presiding officer can't make a motion.
Well, I think I should be able to get to make, so only you guys get to, that means only you guys can, I'm not the mayor. So I'm supposed to be in a position where you two are gonna pick everybody?
Well, you're the presiding officer, you're not allowed to make motions, so that's just, that's the standard procedure.
That's how it goes?
That's the way it is.
Yep, all right, here we go. Yeah, Lance?
I make a motion to appoint Gail Lewis to the council position ending in December 31st, 2012.
I second.
Then motions filed, discussion. Yeah, Lance?
Gail interviewed last week, and here's a person who has a lot of experience with our city budget, which is one of the concerns I think everyone brought up. Had some specific ideas to help our community improve, and has a positive outlook on the future of our community. Again, what we're looking for in a candidate for city council.
Yeah.
I like, you know, he has a lot of experience. He has a lot of experience in history with Cascade Locks. Also, you know, if you try to think of council as being more of a team, then I think that he brings a lot of a lot to the table in that. And you know, he's got a lot of financial experience and some different ideas like that. Again, multifaceted. And so that's fine.
Okay. Same thing. My issues with Gail's, I've been on budget committees with him and been in and seen on the council and all that. And same thing for a person whose job is in finance. I think that has made the budget too simple to punch a right line out there. And I believe that as much as some people don't think we have any financial issues, I believe that there are, and I believe he's helped contribute to those and how he's operating. So I can't support that position. Yeah.
Well, I just know that in my experience with working, and I haven't worked, you know, closely on the council with him or anything like that, but that. When I speak with him, then he speaks, you know, from the best interest, his intent is from the best interest of the community, and that he doesn't, you know, he doesn't have rash thoughts or big political agendas on either side, and I appreciate that, especially with having the financial prowess that he has, and he's one voice in that process, so, you know, in the budget process, we decided a team.
Yeah, I appreciate the, you know, his commitment to the community. I have no problem with him. My issue, because my thing towards the council has been, and where I've been here for trying to push for all the years that I've been here, is financial issues. I believe we have financial problems, and I think that budgets that he helped put together and some put together created some of those financial problems. Now, maybe, you know, I'm not saying they did it intentionally. I'm just saying that the process that ran there, you know, just helped create that as well. Again, that's what I, this year with this budget, people are having a hard time with the budget, but in reality, it's just as Bob said, we learned an awful lot about the budget this year, and it's because we didn't rubber stamp it, we looked at more things. But everything prior to that is that, you know, they're proud of the fact that they had made a really simple 1 or 2 day thing and it's done. And I think that creates problems. So anyway, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Or all opposed? opposed? So, Gail Lewis. So now the third position, which is, or the fourth position, which is not a mayor's position right now, but it's a fourth position, is, and that one will end in just over a year, 12/31/12. Any nominations?
Yes.
You.
Bobby Walker.
Bobby Walker. I'll second that.
Point of order. Presiding officer cannot make a second.
They can't make a second? Oh, yeah, that's cool. So, is there a second? Motion dies for lack of second. Anybody else? Lance.
Make a motion that we appoint Randy Holmstrom to a position ending December 31st, 2012.
I'll second that.
Well, moved second. Any discussion? Lance.
Here again, here's a person who has a lot of experience here in our community, has background on city council, has served on city council, and has a positive outlook for healing the community and bringing us together. And I think that's what we're looking for on this next city council.
Eva.
The thing I like about Randy is that I've had a lot of conversations with him, you know, just meeting in public when you're talking about those community contacts, and I've never heard him speak an ill will of anybody. And I believe that he, you know, makes his decisions from the heart, and that he always has the community in mind.
Okay, well, here we go again. Here we go again, folks. So, yeah, so that's the same thing. I think we've got, we're bringing my opinion in. We just brought, there was election, you know, just over a year ago from the citizens that saw issues in our town and elected in a group. As far as I'm concerned, good politics, good politics jumped on in and changed the show, and here we are, right back to politics. So, I think we just got a group back in there that's ready to. So, all I can say is, in my opinion, hang on to your wallets, folks. So, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Aye. So there you have it. So now we need to get a meeting to see who's going to be the mayor. So how soon do you want to have a meeting?
Can I add something?
Sure.
This is part of what I don't want to happen.
Yeah.
So I want to hit this in the head here, and so I'm going to challenge you a little bit here, and I'm going to challenge anybody. I thought long and hard about these things, and I didn't make it off of because I was friends with somebody or had a favoritism for them, or I looked at some numbers. I really tried to be very careful on how I looked at this. So I'm not going to apologize for anybody that I nominated or voted in. I have an expectation and of everybody that they're going to be open. That's why I tried to pick the people that I looking at them being open and not shutting down the walls right now. Because if we go that way, I don't want to have any walls with you, and I am going to be part of that, part of keeping people in check. I don't want to spend money frivolously. I want to be responsible, and I said at the budget committee, I understand what you're saying as far as the finances. I felt that that it was going to cripple the fire and ambulance department, and said that. But I understood what you were saying, and I don't think that we. I think that if we are open and we work together, and don't shut down our walls right now, that we can make a difference. But we have to agree to do that. I hope that you. I hope that we'll all go and home and think about that, and everybody. And there's committees and stuff. That people, you know, there's openings for committees, there's, you know, things are going to be coming up. So if somebody's not voted on tonight, that they'll look at part of that and be part of the team. That this is part of what we need to do to change what we're doing.
Yeah, Lance?
I mean, along those lines, I really do feel like we had some good, high-quality candidates, and every single person that applied for these positions did bring a unique skill set that really distinguished them from the other candidates. So everybody has something to offer. And I mean, I guess I should have said this at the beginning. I approached this looking at there's four positions, there's 11 people, and we're not gonna select, you know, more than four of those 11. But I do appreciate the people that spent the time to apply for this, that gave their input. And frankly, the things that we heard here tonight, as well as last Wednesday, are a bunch of ideas that are going to help this council move forward in a positive direction. And we're lucky to have all of you here, and we're lucky to have all of you step forward and put your names. And so I want to thank everyone that was part of this process. And hopefully, you know, we can come together and work together for the best interests of the community. We are going to listen to everyone. And we're going to do the best we can to make everyone's ideas part of the final solution here.
Well,
we are the seniors now.
Well, you, like me, are a non-vote. That's the way it is. So you can sit here and go, I was only part of this, but you aren't even, frankly, in my opinion, you're not even part of it. So
all
we can do, but you're going to help bring some rationale to it. I hope that we're able to come up with a good city manager, because I will admit that a lot of the issue, in my opinion, again, has come from bad management, bad administration. So I'm not going to say, it may sound like I'm saying people are all bad people out there that are on it. I believe that the people who are on it have, in my opinion, have had financial issues on where the city can go, and I think that bad administration has helped that. So it very well may be that with a good administration, that good people will make good decisions. I think that, in my opinion, is that good people with bad administration made. Bad decisions. That's what I stand on.
Well, my hope is that we will have a group of people that will be open and work together, and we can make the council one that's going to repair right now. We have that option as long as we don't get angry and we look at things openly, and that's what I'm looking for from everybody. And I will be the first person checking, and I'll be the first person checking with you.
That's what they all said. That's what they all said. They all said it. So again, my critical thing is
But we have to.
We've got good people. I got no question of that. My question is how they manage it financially, and if we wind up with a good administrator, then those good people should shine out here. So hopefully that's the way it goes. But in reality, you and I don't have a vote. So if it wants to go that way.
Maybe we don't, but we matter.
But they did make some glowing things in here, so hopefully they follow the lead of what they.
I thought we had some very good candidates. I was really happy to go through it, even though it was really stressful.
Well, it was. I agree with that. So everybody, I'm impressed with 11 people who applied for it. I'm impressed with how they, made their. Put their thing together on it, and I thought we did a good job giving them the questions were good questions. I thought they were probing enough to give them a chance to say their part of it. And I think we got lots of good answers from them. So we'll, yeah, we're there now. We'll see where we're going to go. So now we need to get a meeting to choose a mayor.
So what we'll have Kathy do is check and see how quickly we can pull a special meeting together and get the justice of the peace. And
okay.
Swear everybody in, and then you can elect the mayor.
All right. So she's going to get back to us on that then.
Right.
Could we kind of go, I have Thursday and Friday this week that would work. In the evening, I'm off on Thursday. So just a thought.
Okay. I'm good Thursday, Friday also.
I'll have to check all their schedules plus just the pace. So Thursday,
no
Friday,
Friday night
preferably.
Meetings. Prefer no Friday nights.
Those are the best ones.
So how about Thursday? If not Thursday, how about the following Monday?
That's Halloween.
Yeah. So
you have to wear a costume.
There you go.
That's not a good
idea.
What does the mayor look like?
Yeah. Okay. Taking my baby trick-or-treating.
So it'll shoot to Thursday, or it will have to be the following Monday.
Or Tuesday.
Or Tuesday.
Or Tuesday.
I'll say it's today.
Okay. I make a nomination.
So. Yeah, make a motion.
Okay. Make a motion that we
Council, before you adjourn, let me just point out this is a difficult thing for any community for three wonderful people to have to face. I think you guys did a wonderful job, and you kept this very open and above board and transparent, and I would think the community would appreciate that. So I want to congratulate the three of you for what you did.
So, motion?
Second.
All in favor of adjourning?
Aye.
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 Aye.